Hallelujah. Yabra. You may be seated, Israel. What a great blessing it is, O God, that Yah grants unto his nation, his people, to come before him and then to offer up the offerings that are acceptable by him. That is magnificent. It is beyond my ability to calculate that within the concept of my natural mindset. We must have the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach to understand the concept, the mighty power, the strength, and the beauty of the Most High. Without that, we will never understand the beauty of Yah. We will allow our minds, the God of our being, to create a concept that is far away from the truth or the reality as to what Torah speaks unto us. And we began from that concept to create our own little entities or allow the shadim, the demons of darkness, to begin to control every aspect of our lives. Those that are led by the Ruach HaKodesh, these are the being, they are the sons, the elected ones of Almighty Yah, because we will hear the voice of Yahshua HaMashiach and the strange allurings of the powers of darkness. We will not condescend. We will not give in to the luring of the spirits of darkness, but we will hear the words of the Most High as he speaks unto his people with great clarity, with purpose, with direction, with assurance, to cause the tikva, the hope of the coming power of his kingdom, to remain alive in us. Once the light of that goes out, we're nothing. We're like a rambling people, destitute, lost, that we gravitate to every kind of unclean, vile, repugnant thing that can be imagined in our minds, that we are led astray by our own imaginations, our own self-righteousness, and then we find ourselves in the cauldron, the quickmire of every kind of dark, devious, evil, wicked practice that one can ever practice. We become practitioners of darkness. Let not our own deceitful love deceive us. We're not going to get by. If we allow the corrupt nature of our flesh, our bazaar is like a buzzard. The nature of our flesh, even with the Hebraic expression, bazaar, it is almost of the same nature of a buzzard, a vulture that eat every rotten, despicable thing that it sees. And so everything that is unclean, then we will consume that. That's not the will of Yah, Yisrael. We should be a clean people. And everything we do should be clean and right. There should never be one centidule of compromising Yah's Torah. I know that Yah, he can fix it for me. Oh, he can. If we just live by his commands, I know that only Yah can fix it every time. We're living by the commands of demonic powers. I want to somewhat conclude today When I make the statement, I will conclude, it is not the end of this teaching. As far as I will take it at this time, I will decease from that on this message. And what we do, we ought to take that and run. We ought to take the teaching to spark within us that this battle is beyond the ability for us within this cluttered mindset that is cluttered by every damnable, wicked thing that opposes Almighty Yah, to understand the depths of the great battle that we are going to encounter in the Ruach, or the spiritual world, first of all, and then it will manifest itself in one of the most physical, fleshly manifestations that one could ever imagine. As we were burying hay the other day, as Ach Yosipia and I said to him, young man, do you understand why this nation and what has been taught to us from birth, not to trust anyone, what that has done and what shall be the end of that? We shall see that as I began to teach on the message of the two witnesses of Almighty Yah. The Shani Him is the two witnesses of Yah. We will understand that. Because this battle is against the gods. This false delusional power that has been created by the rebellionists of Torah. At any time there is a rebellionist against Torah, I don't give a damn who it is. We are not being learned by the Ruach of Yah. We've been led by Shadim, demons, powers of hell, spirits that cause us to operate in rituals of offerings to them that destroys the mind, whereby we will not have this tremendous desire to hear what the Torah of Yah speaks. And as we feed ourselves with truth, it is conveyed unto Yisra'iyah what we are truly eating. The battle is against the powers of hell. Hell has risen up against Almighty Yah to dethrone, to bring the Most High down. And Yah has said, I will create from the dust of the earth An Adum, a man created after my image. And I will give him one of the most prominent things that the powers of hell never possess. I will give them dominion. I will give him power to subdue. I will give him power to think beyond the level of his comprehension. And yet in all of that, I want him to give honor unto me. This is a self-indulgent generation. This is a generation of pride. And we know that pride always goes like Hashatan before his failures, his falling from the presence of Yah. And this most damnable, arrogant, hubris spirit, it is the power of destruction among the nation of Yisra'iyah, because everyone thinks that he or she has the same type of position as everyone else, and it's not so. When one goes to the doctor, one honors what the doctor says. He never questioned the 13, 14 years of residency and studying the doctor has performed. You have never read a medical journal. You don't even understand the concept of diagnosing or the Latin terminology that they use to give many names to diseases. You must understand why they do that. They understand the spirit of the gods. They understand the power of the gods. And that's why the name of most diseases are in Greek or in Latin. We are a generation of people that's willingly ignorant. And when Kepha was speaking that unto Yisraya, he was saying that when one is willingly ignorant, it is a pleasure in your own damnable, twisted stupidity. And we are willingly ignorant. We want to be ignorant. One doesn't question the doctor. He doesn't question his diagnosis, his diagnosing of that disease. Yet when the messenger of Yah speaks of the keli, the disease, the dress of Yisraya, we become very offended. Because of the wickedness in us, the doctor, you concur, you agree, you smile, you rejoice, you accept that. And then you began to proceed on the path that he commands you. If you don't do it, these are the results. When the messenger lays out the halach, the way to walk, the path, or the derech of Yah, the road that we must travel, we resent that. We reject him. We fight him. And thinking not that his diligence of his efforts to study beyond the twilight, when you are asleep, when he labors in the Torah to define the finite details of the way, we oppose that. And we resent that. And we fight against him. And yet we never fight against those messengers of hell. The practice there from Echia, the Greek, the power to draw upon the spirits of darkness is no different than voodoo. It's no different than voodoo. They have it packaged. Do they use some of the most hallucinogenic drugs in voodooism? The mushrooms? And they use some of the most hallucinogenic drugs to alter your mind. Your ability to think, your ability to believe Yah, you don't believe a damn thing. They have drugged us, the gods, in the foods and everything. They incorporated some of the most damnable, unclean things in the foods. We are so damn ignorant and arrogant. Let me say this, and I'm going to teach. Any time this most damnable, twisted god of your belly, your Beth, him rises up, you know that something is wrong to do, and you do it, you are wicked as hell. I don't give a damn who you are. You are wicked. You know, and you think you're getting by because the perception of the eyes of the natural mind doesn't see it, but Yah sees it. You're not getting by with one damn twisted invention of darkness. You're not getting by. I'm not going to shoot with some kind of false analogy. I speak to Yisrael. I am not speaking for the remedy of the world. I'm not trying to heal the world. Yeshua did not try to heal the world. He tried to heal the lost remnant of the house of Yisrael. Those that were scattered in their presumptions of Yehudah to bring them into the Ikah, the oneness of the power of Torah. I'm not trying to pray for the world. I pray for them. I pray not for the world. I pray for them that you would shana, keep them. Watch over them. Preserve them. Impart into them the ruach of your power. That there is no willingness when we take pleasure to defy Yah. Something is twisted in us. We know that it is the God of your belly. And any time the God of our belly speaks in defiance of Torah, you know that it's wrong to do and you do it. You're not even wicked. It's not even a criminal act. The conscience has been seared. And when the conscience is seared, there is not one damn thing that's going to penetrate it. Again, I said, damn every God. Damn every Baal. Damn Zeus, Jesus, Christo, Jesus, Christ. Damn them all. Now you can fall into your seduction and begin your gyration in your mind because you don't understand the concept of what the enemy has done to create one of the most damnable twisted delusions among the annals of what we call religious order upon the face of the earth, to draw Yisrael, man, strangers away, the wayfaring one, from the mitzvah, the Torah of Almighty Yah. And the alluring powers of the gods, the powers are unclean. And we know that the powers are unclean because he that is coming after Hashatan, he is coming with the power of Simeon, with miracles, with unclean power, because he will not give reverence to his name. I don't give a damn who it is. I don't give a damn what they say. I don't give a damn how great the miracle is. If it does not point one to the name of the Most High, then it is a damnable, twisted delusion of unclean spirits from hell. Maybe we need to go back and revisit the teaching many years ago I taught. Can the powers of darkness heal? It tells us in the book of Gilead that they're going to heal, restore, and cause prosperity among his own children. And there shall be a great agony upon the house of Yisrael because of our own wickedness of rebelliousness. We are a nation that willingly rebel, and we must be confronted. We must be confronted. We don't want to be confronted, but we must be confronted. Every action must be scrutinized, my Torah. Every deed must be brought into judgment, as the commands of the Torah command us to do it. Every response shall be brought under the lights of Yeshua HaMashiach. We don't want that, because it reveals everything that is in you. We don't want that. We want the pretense. We want things that really do not search the depths of our own damnable, twisted corruption. That's what we want. We don't want the swords. It's all right if it's blunt. We don't want the sharpness of the two-edged swords. We don't want that. We want something that is blunt. It gives us a form of appeasement in all of our wretched, wicked ways. Damn every damn God. Damn every Baal. every Lord, damn every Christ-door that has the anointing of hell, damn them all. But I do berach my Hamashiach, the one that has been anointed by the oil of Yah, that even his position express who has anointed him. It is the Most High. I want to begin. Let me preface a tremendous Mishli or a Tehillim that David spoke concerning the great agonies of the powers that warred against him to draw him, and the enemies of David, of the kingdom of Yisrael. It was and still represents the kingdom power of darkness that wars against the nation of Almighty Yahweh. He has a nation. And a nation or a chayim, it is a collection of a people with a specific culture. And our culture is developed by Torah. It is a tzaddikha. It is a righteous culture that produces tzaddik, the righteousness, the beauty of the characteristics of Almighty Yah. And so that is the culture of Yisrael, not because we can twist our arse, we can dance, because you can cook fat back and chitlins and beans. That's no culture. A culture is what is cultivated by, to cultivate them, that their cultivation is distinct from all others. And so we as a nation, the people, the culture of our activity is steeped in sin. It is a culture of God worship, that we trust the gods. Yisrael trusts the gods that were made of clay, sticks, stones, their imagination, that even their forefathers did not even surrender to this kind of activity. And we are trusting every damn twisted, deluded, vile god. We have some of the most vilest creations in our minds that we know that they're absolutely wrong. And we defy the Torah of Yah. We say to hell, to the Most High, damn that, because my God commands me to do so. When you understand that it is unclean, you don't give yourself over to that. I don't give a damn what it is. But your God says, defy Yah, and you speak by your actions that you will defy Yah. That's wicked. The day that you eat of that mystery, you shall die. And the day that we eat from the tree that this God, that's why we have abstained. That's why we live in our wickedness and our rebelliousness against Yah. He said, cast that beast out. For if he shall touch or eat from the tree of life, he shall live forever. And your God thinks it promotes you as though you're going to live forever. It is not so. Our lives consist of more than meat and drink. And that's all this nation is about: meat, eat, and drink. We're eating some of the most unclean things because of our spirits are unclean. And we don't give a damn. Can I read this? I will, whether you permit me or not. All right. David speaks here of his power, his submitting unto Yah, how he overcame his enemies in great teshuvah and victory. We will never overcome our enemy unless we identify what's in us. He speaks with great volume here, with great substance here in the book of Tehillim, Psalm 73 and verse 22. I greet you all that have joined us on the live broadcast, on Ustream, wherever you're listening from, and even you, my enemies. I greet you as well, because I shall feed you as well. He said, feed your enemies. David says he uses the words so foolish. Tehillim 73 verse 22. He says, so baha, or so foolish, I was a brutish, stupid man. That is what this folly is. It is baha. He says, so foolish, so brutal and brutish with stupidity was I. And he says, I was naha, I was ignorant. My people are destroyed for the lack of his da'at. This is a willingly ignorant generation. We take pleasure in our ignorance. We are verbose, we will argue, we will fight, and we know that we are ignorant as they come. I was so ignorant, he says, I was as a bohemian. I was like a beast before you, Almighty Yah. And then he alludes, as you continue to read, that how, and the only way that he will overcome this driven force of darkness against him is through his appreciation of Almighty Yahweh, what he has done, and how he speaks unto his elect, his people, to assure them the gods will lead you into the depths of darkness and hell. May I reiterate again, as we began this teaching, as we come to the last of it, the words of the Shilish Ach, the Apostle Shaul, here in the book of 2 Corinthians, there is only one verse I want to read. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4. If the power, the koach, the might, it is the strength, it is the wisdom, it is the knowledge, the understanding of Torah. He says, if this is hidden, if the darkness of the hoshach, the darkness of our minds cannot perceive it, it is because there is a power that rules in the depths of your leba, in your mind, your conscience, your heart, your being, your substance. And the reason why is because you have rejected the Torah of Yah's truth. You have rejected the witness of Yeshua HaMashiach. And you have gone to the gods, and you're blinded now. He speaks in whom? In verse 3, 2 Corinthians 4 and 3. He says, but if Abizarach of the message of truth is hidden, if you cannot understand or see, if you don't like what the messenger says, you have not studied the words to understand the depths of what he has said. You cannot even relate to that. So you draw from your own presumptuousness and you create a doctrine that is far from the truth, and you pursue that. If my, or if the Bezerach, the teaching of Yeshua HaMashiach, if it is hidden, it is hidden from them that is abad. They are meant to perish. He's going to destroy them. If they have no conscience of mind to comprehend the simple speech and the witness of Yah, it is because they are abad. I don't give a damn if it's your sons, your daughters. It is amazing, my young akh, how people will pray for some of the most vilest of individuals, and they won't even pray for me. That's how wicked we are. You will pray for your wicked, doggish son. Oh, save him, young. And yet the messenger, you will never say, strengthen the messenger of Yah, that he may declare it is the truth. Or say, my daughter, but yet Yah sustain the messenger. Keep him. Don't allow him to compromise. This is the wicked generation. I despise it. I don't even like mingling with it because it makes you filthy and unclean. Damn their gatherings, their feasts. They're vile, they're repugnant. The wicked cohabitate with them. They gather with them and they sit down and laugh and grin with some of the most wicked, vile people. And they think they're celebrating you. You're fools. But if this message be hidden, if this laws, if it is Hoshach, whereby the light of Yahshua does not shine through, it is hidden from them that are abad. They are lost. Yah says, I'm going to exterminate them. They're already dead in their sins. He says, you will know that they are abad because in whom? In whom? In whom? In whom? Those that are laws, in whom? In whom? Who? Your sons and your daughters. In whom? In whom? Whom? You, me, others of the same passion as you. In whom? He is in them. In whom? In whom? In whom? Whom is he referring to? Those whereby the power of Torah is hidden from them. Those whose mind is blinded from the Torah of Yah. In whom? In whom? In whom? Who is the whom? Who are those? Who is that one that is whom? In whom? I will, my friend. In whom? In them. In your son, your daughter, your imma, your avats. In whom? In your grandbabies, your granddaughters, your great-great. In whom? I will. And I will take my time, my friend, whether you concur or not. In whom? Them. That one, the God of this Ulam, of this world, he has blinded the minds of them because they don't even believe. If we say we love Yah, we know something is wrong to do and we do it, it is sin. We say we love Yah and keep not, do not guard his commandments. We're liars. And we know who was the liar from the beginning. The God of this world. And you can say you believe, but you don't believe. We sing the song, or Arzachin, but it means reminds us often that 99.9%. will not do Yisrael. He must bring us to that ponim, the perfectly thorough, finished mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. We are the generation for the Akharis, for the time of the end, for the end time, that we should express with great volume the power of our Abba, that men may ask us the reason of this great tigva that's in us, the hope of our eternal existence. I have nothing else to fight for. I will not fight to defend me. I don't give a damn about this flesh. It stinks. It's rotten. And it doesn't take much to corrupt it. If the Bezerach is hidden, in whom the God of this world has blinded the lebah, the minds of them which believe not. They don't trust Yah. They do not trust Torah. They don't believe. I don't give a damn because they can quote his name. The demons of hell can do that. We will justify the wicked. We'll embrace them, and I will condemn you. Something is wrong there. We're excited to see them, but yet no excitement to see Yisrael. Something is twisted in you. The God of this world has blinded them, their minds. It said, lease the light, the oil of the splendid message of Yeshua HaMashiach, who is the image of Yah, should shine to them. The power of Yeshua cannot shine to this generation because the God of this world has caused the powers of darkness. You have more than seven demons in you. We have multitudes of unclean spirits in us. When a power of hell is cast out of a man, it goes to and fro in the earth, seeking a place to find residency. And it says, let me go back to the house that I came out. He comes, he finds it swept and clean. But if you don't keep sweeping, the dirt is going to pile up. If you don't keep sweeping out the damnable wickedness, your damn folly, your damn unclean ways, you're going to invite the gods of the earth in. And when he comes, he finds it prepared, but yet there is no God. There's not the light of Yeshua shining. All we see is the vileness of our damn repugnancy. We're dirty. We're unclean. We're greedy. We're fat for the world. We don't give a damn about Yah. And he enters in to that one. And he brings with him seven gods, Shadim, demons, Baal, lords, Christo, Jesus, Christ, that are more wicked than him. And your last state in the last hour, it is worse than what it was in the beginning of your embarking upon the way of Torah. And we are wicked and we don't give a damn. I think that it was Achim Ben Amid, he brought out on Chat Ve'imet about the slothfulness of Yisrael. That when we are slothful, it causes us to be relegated to poverty. And it's one thing that a man in poverty, his mind, his conditions, and where he lives, it is an incubator of all kind of viruses and diseases. Because he doesn't have the ability to bathe like the one that has the accommodation. And so when we don't bathe ourselves in Torah, we become filth and parasites, and all kinds of bacteria began to lay their eggs in our minds. And then our minds become diseased. We don't want truth. We want things that are not beneficial to our living. And then we have no chayil, no strength, no power of the might of Yah. And we become selfish and wicked. And we defy him. I'm speaking to Yisrael, damn the world. Damn this wicked world. I say that all the time, all during the day. Damn it. It is wicked. Damn it. Damn this wicked world. My constant prayer is, Yah, tear it to hell. You shall suffer, man. I know. But I have a tikvah. I'm reminded that his Sadiq, that we said, I've been young, I'm old, for I've never seen the Sadiq of Yah forsaken. Or his Zira out begging bread. He shall feed me. He shall feed me. Not for the famine of bread, the famine of the hearing to assure us. We eat much bread, but we are not walking in the assurance of Torah. The God of this world has blinded their minds, lest the power of Torah shine, and we began to create the vivid beauty of the picture of Yah, unless the message of Yeshua HaMashiach, the truth of this message, shine not unto us, that it is the light in which we walk in. It is the light in which we rejoice in, and it caused the brightness of the light of Torah to be fulfilled in us. It is the power of the gods, and your God is a damn fool. His people are sottish and foolish. Your God is a damn liar. Your God is a damn beast. And every damn god is a damn beast. It's a damn unclean thing. Yah's going to damn them all. He's going to cut off every damn god. Again, he says here in the book of 1 Corinthians 8:5, I will get to the definitive of the word God today. Don't worry. I cannot finish this in one or two, three, four, five teachings. I can teach on this for the next 10 years. I can take one word and preach on that 100 sermons or better, more than that. It is that when we labor in the Torah, we press beyond our unknowledgeable, ignorant ways, we can begin to get insight. And I don't give a damn what we do, it is proven. What is in the ingredients of us, I don't give a damn. If you labor, if you work with others, others will see what's in your love. If you're sorry, everyone will know you're sorry. If you're lazy as hell, you're trying to get by, everyone will know that. When I labor with a man, I want to leave one impression. This man will work. I don't give a damn how I feel physically. When I finish at the end of the day, you will know that he's genuine. Because everything that I represent is of the wealth of that which Yah has placed in me. So I do all things as unto him. Everything. Shaul says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 5. He says, For though there are rab, many, not smi'ud, there are many who are called gods. And I will show you some of those that are called gods that you don't even register in your damn twisted mind as we as a people. And yet we relegate that to some of the most despicable things there is upon the face of the earth. For though there be many that are called gods, whether they are above us in Hashemayim, or if they be in the earth, the Erecha, beneath the Ulam, he says, as there Rab, innumerable without numeric measure, there be many gods. And lords, Baal, he says, many. There are many lords. You lord the commands of Yah, you interpret them the way you want to. You are the Lord. You are the one that commands Yah, and you will go to hell. You're not going to command him. You will go to hell. You're going to die in your wickedness. He said, there are many lords and many gods. I want you to understand in verse 6, but to Yisrael, but to us, there is but one mighty one. He is our Abba. He has birthed us. He has fathered us. He is the progenitor of our species among mankind. There's only one Abba, in whom, just like in whom the God of this world, in whom the God of this world has blinded, but in whom, is not the phraseology the same? Is it not the same? Did it not say here in 2 Corinthians 4:1, in whom the God? It is one thing that the enemy has done to us. We don't pay attention to Yah. We don't pay attention to the words and the expression. But every kind of wicked saying and every kind of damnable twisted innuendo and gossip, you hear every word precisely, because this is a damn wicked generation. I am not taking one word back. Just like in whom the God of this world has blinded, it says in whom are all things. In Yah are all things. And we in him, Yisrael in him, and one master, Yeshua HaMashiach, by whom are all things, and we by him, by Yeshua are all things. How can that be, my friend? He is the Dabar. He is the word. He is the promises of Yah. He is the speech of Yah. He is the Amir, the utterance of Yah's breath. He is the utterance of Yah's lev. He is the utterance of the fullness of Yah. That's what he is. He is the Torah. He is the word of Yah. And so everything in him, all that we need is in the Torah. All that we need. And if we will bathe ourselves accordingly, you will not give room to the damn gods of this creation. That's why you defy Yah. You defy what he says. We rebel against him. Because the damn gods tell you to. You rebel against what's right. You're not going to love anyone else. We were reminded on Kadfe Imat, more than you love Yah. Brother, sister, mama, daddy. It's amazing that people say they love their damn wicked sons and daughters, and they don't even love Yisrael. They tolerate their damn wickedness, their gods, they embrace their gods. Go to hell, you cowardly beast. I don't give a damn who you are. Go to hell. You will go. They will love and embrace the vile, wicked sons and daughters, be happy to see them. And yet there is no entertainment of Yisrael. You are wicked. You are a son of hell. You are a daughter of harlotry. I don't give a damn who you are. I will, man. I don't give a damn how you respond to me. Kids. Right with Yah and do it now. Get right with Yah. Let the Torah show you how. Get right down at Yeshua's feet. Oh, I don't sing it the way you go clap, because We have been trained to clap. We've been trained to sing it that way. I don't want to sing it that way. In whom? In whom what? In Yah. In whom? Who? The God of this world has blinded the minds of the people. In whom do you trust? Yeshua said, in whom do you believe in? In whom do you think that I am? He's in Yah. And we in him, we are the light of the earth. We are like a tremendous city that sits upon a hill. We emanate the power, the beauty, and the brilliancy of the lights of Torah, the seven Re'achim of Yah. And we are weakly and beggarly because the gods don't give a damn about you. They strip you naked. That is one thing the gods do. They strip you naked and show you you're not worth a damn to them. Can I read a little bit? All right. I'm going to define the God thing, all right. It says here, hallelujah, in the book of Bereshit. I want to read this again. Hallelujah. Bereshit chapter 3, verse 7. It says, in the defiance of Almighty Yah, it says here in Bereshit, Genesis 3, 7, and the eyes of the Ayin. And our Ayin has been opened, our mental perception, our spiritual calculation of matters. And their eyes, the Ayin, of them both, Adam and Chava Eve, they were pachad, pachad. They were open. And we are taught in this nation to be open-minded about matters, to not close our minds. I close my mind from the damn gods and the twisted Christos and the twisted Christ and Jesus and all of these damnable twisted images that were created by an open mind and presented to a nation of people that caused them to defy the Torah of Yah. And you find every kind of religious whorehouse today established in the name of the Jesus, their Jesus, their Christo, and they're thumping like they do in the damn wicked night places of every kind of reputed sin it is. It's no different. And there are the spiritual determination to master what they perceive. For them to take oversight. You're always intended for the Torah to take oversight over our perception, over our imagination, our thoughts, and we are guided by the living power of the Torah from the beginning. And so their ayin were open, their eyes, their mental and the spiritual, what the liveliness of what they saw to create emotions in them. What create emotions in you? When you're dealing with the ruach or a spirit, you're dealing with life and breath. And so what things cause you to be animated? Foolishness? We don't even respond to Yah as a nation of people, but some of the most repugnant folly, you will smile and grin. But when it comes to Yah, we're not animated at all. I don't give a damn how I sound, what I sing to anyone. I sing with the gusto of the liveliness of his beauty in me, of his testimony. What is that testimony? Because Yeshua is real. Well, he is real in my nephew. I can feel him all in me. He is real. He is real. You say that, but it's not real to you. The only thing is real is the God of our damn belly. They cause us to defy God. To defy Yah. We eat every kind of damn unclean thing. We will do things that are unclean. We ponder them. We imagine them. We do them. And then, above all, we practice some of the most vilest unclean things. This is the power of the gods. When their eyes were open, They determined in the spiritual sense, their eyes were pokhad when they had the ability to perceive that I am a master. I have determined what is appropriate and right for me. Isn't that what open-mindedness is? Nobody tells me. I determine. You don't determine one damn thing. You go to the ghettos and the hood and the impoverished nation and people, and we are much more impoverished than them. We eat like damn hogs. We are beastly. Our minds are not developed. You go to those nations, they will speak 2 or 3, 4 languages, and hell, we can't even speak English. Talk to me, Israel. Hallelujah. I'm a beast man. It's a terrible thing to fall into Yah's hands. We don't know him. And your religious harlotry is going to get us all in trouble. The song back in the days, everybody plays a fool sometimes. See, you don't play a fool all the time. We have been the foolish, the ba'ah of Yah, stupidly foolish. This book is not written to the world. It is written to his Bahir to show them the examples of his people, what it produced, that we are not allured by the same things as they were lured by. That is who this book is written by. The world cannot interpret it. It takes a messenger, one that has the oil of the godness of God, Yahshua, in their bosom to reveal that. And if we don't have that, if you don't sit down and read the Torah with gladness, you are just spinning your damn wicked wheels. You're doing it for exercise. You're crazy. You're just doing something. There's no delight in it. Because when one delights, can I give us an example? I love pound cake and chocolate too. Don't make many of them. I love chocolate pound cake. And you get 3 nice slices of that, about that thick. I don't want them too thick. Just 1 scoop of ice cream. Don't want much. And a banana with that. I mean, what can you do? It costs the inward parts to feel happy. That's what food is for, is to, as we give Torah, it is to comfort us. It's become a hog thing today, to comfort us, to make us appreciative, because he gives us bread today. That's why they call some food comfort foods. You get comfortable, you feel, you feel so nice. And that is what the Torah is. It is the comfort food of Yah. It feeds us. It heals our sickness. When we were sick, did not our parents know the right food, soups to feed us? So we are people of diseases, Khali. We have learned from Misraim, from Egypt. And we are just like those of Misraim, the Egyptians. We have learned the ways of the world. We'll try to incorporate that with Yah, but you're not going to win. You're not going to win. You've already lost. The eyes were open, both of them, and they yada that they were irum. They were naked. They realized that they were naked. They realized that they were naked. It was not the Torah of instruction that showed them they were naked. It is the blatant defiance, and we are naked people. That's why when we come before Yah, when someone speaks to our issues, we become shameful, we become angry. They were naked. And so they tried to wrap themselves in the promises unto Israel,
And that's what many are doing today. They're trying to wrap themselves in the promises, but they are not the zero of promise. They're not going to lay hold onto the promises of Yah. And Yah says, cast them out. You're cast out like vagabonds. And yet, Yisra'ya, we can eat from the tree of life, the tree of healing, the tree, Yahshua HaMashiach, in the midst of the garden. What is a garden? As Zachariah Ramiah, he constantly reminds us, what is the garden? It is the garden whereby you have weeds and all kinds of things grow. You must constantly rid them. You must constantly hoe or take the sword and cut the weeds. You must constantly do that, Yisra'ya, that the weeds and the thorns and the thistles do not choke up the word of Yah. And the Torah is falling on ground that is hard, nothing but thorns and thistles and weeds, and we don't give a damn, because the God of this world has blinded the minds, the masses of the people. And we don't want to hear the Torah of Yah. We take consolation in wickedness. You know something is wrong. You know something is twisted in your damn mind. Your wicked ways, you take consolation and you justify. No. They realized that they were naked. We are naked before Him. That's what we are. We are naked. You can hide, but you're not getting by. Your sins will uncover you, for He sinned from the beginning, or Shatan. Why? Because his mind was not developed by the beauty of Torah. And that's why we constantly sin, as we were reminded, we were reproved and repudiated, that we sin not, we practice not defiance of the Torah of Yah, and be led by the God of your own damn belly to cause you to defy Yah. And we sin not, that are born of the Ruach of Yah, that are led by the Ruach, the Torah. We don't practice and we sin not. Hallelujah. I know that a Sadiq man, Nafal, he fall seven times, but you don't even understand that. One day, I'm going to teach on that. Hallelujah. I know he Nafal. Hallelujah. They realized that they were naked, so they tried to sew the aprons as we are trying to embrace the teaching of Yahshua HaMashiach, to say that we are the sons of Yah, we are born of the Ruach of Yah, we are the sons of Yah, and trying to embrace the covenant unto the Zira of Abraham. And out of that covenant, out of that, it was promised through the Zira of Yitzchak and Yaakov. And so we try to embrace that, but it's not going to work, Yisra'ya. We're naked, and we must be covered by the Sadiq clothing of Yah's righteousness. We must cover ourselves. You're covering your damn sins, because HaShatan is a liar, a deceiver. He is the God. You don't believe in Torah, and you're covering your damnable, twisted ways. And we're not going to win. Hallelujah. We've already lost. And that's why we're impoverished. That's why we're poor. We look poor. We look sick. Blind mind has no concept of direction of one's own. We don't have no concept of Yah's direction. We don't see where it leads us to the beauty of His presence. We love the leading of the gods, but not Yah. They realized that they were blind and they were naked. I want to give you an express example of that nakedness, and show you what it represents, and the vision of that in the eyes of the Nobi, the prophet, as he saw it. Quickly,
the book of Yeskel, Ezekiel. Jump to 23, I want to read. In order for us to have any kind of understanding to grasp the depths of this arum, this nakedness and clothe, our minds are not clothed with the mitzvah of Yah. Our minds are not clothed with the tzaddik of Yah. Our minds are not thoroughly furnished with the commands of Almighty Yahweh to show us the results and what this nakedness constitutes. The Nabi speaks here. Here in Ezekiel chapter 23 and verse 29. Yah says that they and those that deal with you with this sin or this hateful type nature. And we deal with each other with a hateful nature. That is, there's a hatefulness. And it's wrong. That is when we broken eyes into all those spears. You understand what balkanization is? It is those of the same mind, of the same nature, of the same desire. They group together and they form this block of resistance. So we balkanize against Yah. Those that zina, that are very hateful, a hatefulness of not of shonye, but sin, it is very hateful. It is beyond hatefulness. It is a despising. It is not an embracing. We love the damn gods, but we are hateful toward Almighty God. He gives us examples now. Listen. He says that are very hateful and shall take away your labor. It is even your hatefulness toward Yahn Torah that take away your labor. You think you're doing right. We're not doing wrong. He's speaking of the enemies of Yisrael. Those that come against them and to expose their very nature. And that is what Hashatan, the God of this world, does. He exposes how naked we are. And he leaves you naked because he doesn't give a damn. There's a lady that she came other day, she called me, wanted to rent our place. I said to her, we don't rent here. She drives down to visit me. I recall her son, how this boy would beat the hell out of her. He would break the windows in this house that Zachin lives in. And I recall one Shabbat evening, I went up there. And I said, what's wrong with you, boy? You stop that. I was not fearful of my life. Why? Because if a coward would kick the hell out of his mama, he ain't worth a damn, he's a coward. He would be afraid to touch me. You understand? I said, I want you to stop that now. He had burst the windows out. She's crying. And I said to him, what's your problem, boy? He began to weep. Look at me. I haven't accomplished anything. I haven't done this, because he was allured by his own vile, wicked actions. And that's why we don't accomplish the things of Yah, because it is our own wicked actions that allure us and draw us. There are those that are hateful, sin'ah, toward true Yisrael. And they want to take away all of our labor. He says, and they shall leave you a room. They shall leave you naked. And they shall leave you Ephraim bare, an exposing of your nakedness that you see beyond your nakedness.
and the nakedness of your own damn whoredom. That is what HaShatan brought out of Hava and Adam. It showed them this is what a God does. He said, you shall see the nakedness of your own whoredoms. And not only that, you shall be discovered, both your lewdness and this what Yah is doing. He's discovering our lewdness, our zima, our wickedness, our evil, mischievous, wicked plans. Do we lie on our beds and plan wicked things, even against our neighbor, our re'ach? Sure we do. That is the kingdom of the gods. I will show you that when I define that. Give me some time. I must lay this out. Then I will define the word God. And show you how damn repugnant and how damn wicked it is to call the Most High God. I don't give a damn what these intelligentsia speak and say, damn their wickedness. Even from their own doctrines, it shows you the ignorance of their concepts and how unlearned they are. Back in the days, we would hear in the community, if you want to understand the man, just watch him. You will find out what he's about. That's all you got to do. Watch the man. You will see what he's about. You will know how to interact and to deal with him. You will know how to deal with the circumstances. Just watch the man. He said, your own nakedness of your own zimnun, your own damn idolatry. What is idolatry? It is the worship of gods. The gods that you have created, your belly, our belly creates all kinds of damn gods. How is it at midnight we're thinking about a damn chocolate popsicle ice cream double fudge sandwich and there is not even prayer in our loins? You might as well respond to me. I leave no rocks unturned. The Ruach of Yah leave no rocks unturned. At 10, we are craving and desperate for a damn lemon drop pound cake with a scoop of Mississippi mud ice cream, and y'all's not even on our damn minds. And we will get up frantically to feed the damn God, driven by a God that doesn't give a damn about you. And yet we've never driven to fall on our faces and say, what a wretched, wicked damn thing I am. You get up at midnight and traverse through the perils of darkness to find some of the most ridiculous damn things it is. Some of the most foolish things there are. We will do that. When it comes time for Yah, you may not say to hell, but we say it. Yisra, that's how we talk to the Most High. Oh, I would not. We are liars. I was a child that was brought up just like anyone else with the best of my mother's ability. But I sure talked under my breath to her. I sure talked back in my mind. And you are a damn liar if you say you have not. I talked under my breath. I talked back in my mind. And I said what I wanted to say. I may have not said it to her face. Oh, I never done that. You're a damn liar. You did that. Your actions from a child, we've done that. And that's why as children of God, we still perform the same kinds of things. We just don't want to be confronted with it because we think highly of ourselves and we think we're better. We think we've done differently. You have done as wickedly as I have done. Well, I've never committed adultery. Well, hell, you've done everything else that is associated and much more repugnant than that. Well, speak your damn lies to me. If a man breaks the Torah of Yah, he is a wife. Husband did something wrong in his days. She reminds him of that all the time. He is a wife that did something wrong in her days. And the husband reminds her of that all the time. Hell, and yet they never remind themselves of their own wickedness. I got trouble because he did this. No, your trouble is not because he did that, you Jezebel. Your trouble, you jackass of a simpleton of a man. That's not your trouble. Your trouble is your own damn wickedness and your sin that hinder you. It is the power and the nature of your God. We don't want to confront the God issue.
That's the truth. He did this. Jezebel, tell me what you've done. She did that. You damn fool, tell me what you have done. It all took the dam of your shoe to cover us with blood. You speak with such vile, twisted, damn stupidity. You will be surprised at the people that live that way. It's not killing the mate, it's killing them. It's not killing her, it's killing him. And they say they forgive. You are a damn liar. You don't even know how to forgive. That's how we can integrate with each other and forgive each other. Hallelujah. Well, he did that wrong. Man, we got work to do. I don't have time for that. Let's get up and roll. Let's move. Now, don't do the damn childlike thing again. Let's go, man. Oh, that's my nature. Oh, you're boasting? No, that's just the way I am. If it had not been for Yahshua on my side, tell me where would I be? We're nothing without him. And your God shall leave you to the pits of hell. He shall lead you and leave you there. And that's a fact. He wants you to be naked. We see that in this nation. Everything is naked, isn't it? Well, they're naked on the continent of Africa, but the sexuality is not promoted there like it is here. The men don't look at the women, and the men, women don't look at men that way in the same breath. It is a wickedness here that is beyond reproach. And the gods are flourishing in their god power. That's why you have goddess and gods, stars and superstars, like a supernova. A star that is so bright, so big, you can't even measure the dimension of it. That is what a supernova is. There are certain stars, they don't even know the size. You can't even measure the size. You can't even measure the diameter. They're so huge, so bright, so big, so gigantuan. There's no expression in the vernacular of mankind to express the beauty, the awe of those bright stars. This universe, the galaxy that it is in, is the expressions that man used, is beyond the ability to even reach just a one-tenth of the slith or 1 billion of a tenth of a meter of the depths of this earth. So high, so wide. You don't understand the depth of it. That's the power of Torah. You must understand, as we see the universe, that's what Torah is. It is so broad, so beautiful. It is such an expression of creation in us and such power. And yet we relegate ourselves to the damn gods. This is what Yah spoke. He spoke an air and he spoke in the beauty. Look at the trees. This is what he spoke and he brought into existence. It is the power of his words. It is the power of Torah to create the power of the image of Yahshua in us. And we let the damn gods speak to us. And they create every kind of damn wickedness. You can tell the volume. The substance of one. And their attitude, their personality, you can tell that. Sure you can. You can tell when they're not worth a damn. In my days, they would see old Willie John walking down the street and say, that boy ain't worth a damn. Sure they said that. And they could see old Bob June walking down the street and say, that boy, he's going somewhere, look at him. They can see Mary Lucinda, she's walking down the street, that's a hoe if there's a hoe. They would keep it quiet. And they would see Bertie Lucinda and they would say, that little girl, she's such a beautiful girl. Am I telling the truth, my Ema? Talk to me again. All right. I recall things very vividly as a young child because I'm very attentive to things. We can't even discern the face of the sky. We can't even discern the times of his coming. Because we're so damn wicked that God has blinded our minds. We don't want Yahshua to shine. We don't want the light of Torah to shine. We don't want truth to shine. So we dwell in Hoshek and darkness and wicked things that are subtle. Was not Hashatan the most subtle creature in the garden?
Let me read. Let me move on. Hallelujah. 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 Yah says here, again here in the book of Yeskel, I want to read a lot of that. He said, in the nakedness of your zanun, your idolatry, shall be discovered. That's what he's doing today to Yisrael. Both your lewdness, your zina, your tremendously evil, wicked plans. We plan wickedness in our mind. That's what the gods do. The plans are against Yah. He said, and your tasnuth or and your whoredom or your harlotry, your idolatry is going to be exposed. And that is what the nakedness exposed. The idolatry, what happened after that? We see the idolatry, how it proliferated on the face of the earth and gods and the multitude of gods because it opened up an escape route. The heavens for that moment, the curtains were pulled back and the powers of hell, they came down by the tens of millions, the hundreds of millions. And then the word closed up those heavens again until the Akarif, the end times, the days that we are in Yisrael. And they came and they saw the beauty of the Beth Zion, and they interact and produce sons that were renowned men, Nephilites, powerful men in the earth. We see the same spirit today. That's why a man can bounce a basketball and he becomes a superstar. We are the dumbest people on the earth. You know why we're dumb? Because we don't want to be taught. We don't want nobody to teach us. It's like an arrogant child. I know what to do. You don't, little girl. Stop. We'll show you how to write A, B, C. Oh, I know how to do it. My mother did it. Oh, see there, I did it. Oh, that's right. No, it's wrong. You did not do it right. It's wrong. It's wrong. You don't tell them lies like that. You began creating lies. The spirit of Hashatan. No, it doesn't look. You're wrong, baby. You said you know how to do it. Well, mama, no. You didn't do it right. It's wrong. You hurt their little feelings. You tell me a child's little feelings hurt. What is that? We're stupid. We'll let faggot god dogs like Zeus and Dr. Spook and all these, what a damnable name, to write books, Dr. Spark. We let the muffins and all these damn wicked creatures teach and train your sons and your daughters that you don't even have the damn intellectual sense of what is right and wrong, because the gods have twisted your damn minds, and our minds are so damnably twisted. We are dysfunctional when it comes to the Torah of Yah. I'm not going to dress it up. We've been dressed up phonily too long. We dress ourselves in phony fashions. It's time to speak the real stuff. Time to expose the depths of the gods in Yah's kingdom. Trying to displace him and overthrow him. That is what your God like mine is. What I believe is that. I don't give a damn what you believe is wrong. The Torah says this. Well, I don't see it that way because of your own nakedness, you don't see it. Your own tasnuf and your own idolatry, your own God worship, you will never see it, Israel. We need someone to stand strong. Raise up the Nobi, Yah. When Yah would remove the Nobi from the midst of Israel and the Shaftim to bring the Shafat, his judgment, his instruction, they went down a deep spiral spin of wickedness, did they not? And when we remove the Ruach, and that is one of the Ruachim of Yah, the Ruach of Mishpatim, we remove that, we become a wicked people. And we don't want nobody to remind us how wrong we are. We as children, you parents, you should remind your children when they're wrong, you remind them. We don't want nobody to remind us how damn wicked we are, how slothful, and how childlike we don't want nobody to do that. I'm talking to you. For some reason, people think that I'm just talking to us here. Well, you are there listening to me. I'm talking to you and the world that will hear this message. This is for Yisrael. And if you're Yisrael, you fall under the same umbrella, and your situation is probably worse.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yah says, Bereshit, chapter 3, verse 22. He drives them from his presence. Genesis 3, 22. And Almighty Yah, the Abba of Yisrael, said, he says, Hina, behold. He said, Adon has Chaya. He has, or he is become Chaya. Those that say and ascribe that to his name, it is simply a verb, and a name is a noun, because it speaks of a person, place, or thing in our vernacular and in the languages of the earth. It may not be called a noun, but it has a specific. When he says the word is become here, it is chaya, it is an adverb. That's what it is, a verb. And it speaks of only to arise, he has risen. He appears, not that he is. A chameleon appears to be as though that it is the object that it is on and a part of that, but it's not, is it? We are a pack of clowns, what we are. In the days they would say, man, no clown around. We ain't dealing no clown now. We ain't going the clown way. So he said, man has high here. He appears. He has become, he uses a verb. It's not a noun, a person, place, a thing, and a pronoun, a specific. So my name will be Yisrael, that is a pronoun. This is the ignorance, the arrogance, the most damnable, twisted stupidity of this generation. And what I find, I've always been this way. I'm not boasting in any damn thing I have, because I have nothing. I've always been a student. When someone teaches me something, I was not offended. I will never forget Evangelist Hartsfield. He said to me, you use that word too much, you stop it. And my words, my reply, as I was a young, ignorant boy, I, the strength of my youth rose up, and I looked that man. He had green eyes. Were they brown eyes? He was like Robinson eyes. He had brown eyes. They were dark. They were just like, you know, that eyes. And he looks at me and he pierced me with those eyes. And I said to him, whatever it takes, you tell me. I will obey it. This is a generation, you tell them what we like. We kind of get staunch and upset because we think we have a lot. We don't have a lot. I don't have a lot. You don't have a lot. So the little I have, I want to give that to us, that we may have a little that a tzaddik man has is greater than all the wealth of the wicked, the rasha. So give me your little, and I give you my little, and you give me your little, and we give each other our little. Then we have much among ourselves. Consider the odds. Each one does little, just a little piece. But they supply everything. They have one purpose, the queen. The queen. And now the ants hives today. There is more than one queen. It was at a time it was just one. But they understand the power to eradicate and to destroy. So there are multiple queens. There are multiple queens. There was a time that a pride of lions consisted of one male. And now they call them super prides. They're 3 and 4 males, young, strong males, that if two has to go and mark their territory,
There's always two or three there to guard the lioness and to take down that 5,300-pound Cape Buffalo. And they take him down. They need the male to take down the Cape Buffalo. There are some bad girls, but they need the male. You understand? Even in nature, Yah shows us that we need man. And we have relegated him down to a despicable thing. We disregard. You disregard him. If Yahshua is your ish head, you disregard him. You will say, no, I don't disregard Yahshua. You are a damn liar, woman. If Yahshua is my head, you disregard me. And you say, no, I don't disregard Yahshua. You are a, I would say the GD damn liar. You are Jezebel of a liar. You are a filthy liar. You are a repugnant, stinking liar. And if I disregard the Torah of Yah, Yahshua, the instructions, then I don't give a damn about the Most High. We are a stupid generation. We think we're smart. It's our own conceit that tricks us and makes us think that we are smart. You disregard Yah is the head of Yahshua. Yahshua is the head of every man. What is a man? One that has the breath and the power of Yah's witness, the aid of Yahshua in his bosom. You disregard that. You disregard Yahshua. You can say you love him all you want to. You're a damn lying, wicked Jezebel. Give a damn what you say, woman. Okay, what you say, man. And that's the truth. Man is the head of woman. Who's a man here? He has the Ruach of Yah. He'll be the head. Not to lay with the women. He's the head. He will instruct them and guide them in the ways of Yah. That's why every man needs Yahshua as his head. Yahshua is not weak. He's strong. When he speaks, it is powerful. When he spoke here, am I the all? Went backwards. We have to speak with the same veracity of tenaciousness that sin will take a back seat. Your own wickedness will take a back seat. Even when I was laboring with Evangelist Hartsfield, if he did not preach to cut the hell out of me, I didn't want to hear it. Say something that will show me my wickedness, man. When he would talk like that, I said, I love you. I was, man, I love you so much. Baby, we're going to give all our money this week. Okay. And we'll be as broke as they come. No food. That's all right. Those words made me fat. And it gave me substance. Hallelujah. I will, my friend, appreciate that uplifting to strengthen my bosom because I need that. Hallelujah. 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 Yah says that man Adam, he has chaya. He has arisen. He appears like one of us. One of us. Well, he's talking to Yahshua. No, he's talking to the elders and the chos. The melechim did not rebel against Hashatan. He says, become like one of us. Were the elders in Hashemayam? Let's use this for an example. The elders, the four and the 20 elders, 24 of them, that are on the throne of Yah, are they of the same magnitude of excellence as Yah? We use the word God. Okay, if he, the mighty one, is a God, are those that are in Hashemayam, are they gods as well? Are they of his same peril, his same equal, or do they have the same appearance as Yah? No, they don't. No, they do not. He said, they have become like one of us. I've imparted into you by my speech what is right, what is tall, what is evil, because what I speak, if I say life, it's life. If I say death, it's death. He said, I've become like one of us. They know, they understand. How could they get that? Because once they defied, they open up their hearts to the God, Hashatan. And immediately he filled the void in them. That's why when Yah came down, they hid. That's why your damn gods will hide in a superficial way. When he comes down, He makes himself known by his judgment of the gods. And so you pretend and you hide yourself and you look nice and you look all appropriate. But deep in your damn heart lies the gate of wickedness. It is open unto the furnace of hell, and you're full of falseness and pretense. That's us as a nation and as a people, my young friend. Truth. When Yah spoke, they hid themselves. When Yah speaks to us, we hide ourselves in our own self-righteousness. And we pretend that we care for someone. We don't give a damn. And watch those that were here, they always grinning. I knew it was false. I knew it was not a genuine smile. Full of pretense. I said, look at this wicked fool. Don't even want to greet him. Don't even want to greet her. I wasn't born yesterday. And I'm glad that even though the perils I have encountered, I'm glad that I experienced what I have. I am. So I can speak from a position of understanding of certain matters, whether you buy it or not. Can I move a little farther with this? Hallelujah. He says, become like one of us to Yada to understand tough and evil. He says, and now at this time, Yisrael, if we were able, least peradventure, he put forth his hand and take of the tree of life. If we could truly eat from the tree of life today, we will live in this perpetual state of evil wickedness that we perform. That's why we must die. See, he allowed us to taste. Oh, taste, yeah, taste the Torah and see how tough it is. No, he doesn't allow us to eat. Oh, taste and see. He allowed us to taste. Granny baking that cake, she did not cut the cake. She would taste the batter. Girl, this is going to be good here. Yes, ma'am, it is. Yes, simple recipes, didn't she? She would make that old cream up for that cake and she would taste it. She would taste it. And the little ones just sitting there drooling. She didn't make 10 cakes. She made one cake. And everybody just sitting there drooling. Can we have the bowl? And you got the bowl when she finished. You didn't get the cake. He is this bread of life. We have tasted. We have tasted the little book. But yet in our mouths, it is bitter. We have not allowed it to go down into the Bethlehem, the belly, into the nefesh of our lives. We have not, Yisrael. He has become like one of us. He understands what is tov and what is ra. His eyes have been opened. His mental determination, his understanding has been opened that he will determine what is right and what is wrong. We determine that, don't we? It is the truth. You determine what is right. We will justify our wickedness. But you condemn my right. You condemn the justification of Yah in your ach, in your chot. Don't we do that? We do that, my friend. I will. It is the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said we must put him out, lest he eat and live olam. He lives forever. So he says to Yisrael, I'm going to put you out unless you eat and live forever. And so if we could eat, if we could understand, if we could enter into that beautiful paradise, that place of Yah in Yeshua, we just at the threshold, at the door. We just don't know how to get in through the veil. We don't know how to. Because we don't realize that we're naked, dirty, we're wicked. And we think because of a nice deed, that doesn't make you right. Hell, Mr. Bill Gates, Mr. Warren Buffett, combined their philanthropy efforts, 60 plus billion. They do nice things, but they kill people. And they think that that's going to be the catalyst of their of their fulfillments of life, and then in the other world they're going to receive great rewards. It's not so. Lazarus was a poor man, and the rich man was rich. He said in his life he had all he had, for he served the gods well. And we're serving the gods well. We're serving the gods well. We're serving the God of our belly well. It's visible on us, visible in us, visible in our appearance, visible in our actions, visible in our minds, visible in our attitudes. But it's not the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach, because that mind pleased the Most High. We're pleasing the damn gods of the Baal, the Lord Jesus, and all of these damn twisted origins of hell. But yet we're not trying to please Yah. And we think we're going to get by. Well, don't talk loud to the ark like you. That's all right. I talk loud. I hug and embrace, and let's go to work. Come on, man. Let's go to work, man. All right, we got it done. That's all right. Hallelujah. We have been taught to resent any instruction. We're trained that way. We have no regard. No respect. No respect. We have respect the person, but we have no respect for the things of Yah. Hallelujah. I want to read one more, and then I want to get into the depths of this little booklet. Simeon, will you pass this out? Do we have these ready? Can you that, Yabarak, you all, you that have gathered with us here at Teshua community, the reason I did not want to pass them out earlier, because I didn't want you all to get ahead of yourselves, all right? Just hold on to it as he gives you one. And you that have joined us on the live broadcast, my Ach Simeon, it is available to them as well. It is available. And this is a little research. I want to read some, but I want you to hold on to this and keep this little booklet, because it is a plethora of information. This is not anything that I have determined by my own knowledge or my own wisdom. It is what is laid out in the chronicles and the annals of man, his determination, his definitive, his meaning of words. I have not created one damn word at all. You understand? Not me. I have not created any word. And we as a nation of people, we define words by our social eco environment. We define words by how they are defined to us. And that is not how the word is defined. It was not the original intent of the linguists. And the linguistics, or the linguists create the linguistics. And the linguistics is the speech pattern to express, to describe, to open the mind, to paint a picture as to what they're trying to convey. Now just hold on, don't open it up. Just wait for me, all right? Please do that for me, okay? Don't worry, just close it up. Just wait for me. That's why I didn't pass them out, because I know that we will be looking, we will not pay attention. Hallelujah. That's what they do in school. They say, all right, now hold up. Don't even turn the test over, turn it down. The teacher will walk and turn the test down. Nobody get a head start. Nobody gets a jump on nobody. And then, all right, began the test. That's how it's always been done, Yisrael. Hallelujah. I want to read one more verse before we go there. You just hold that, please. Don't go there yet, all right? And then we will begin this teaching. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't Yah wonderful? He is great. And he is a blessed assurance to his people. Is he not? Is he not the strength of our tikvah? Our hope? Sure he is. Hallelujah. I want to read this last verse in Bereshit. Genesis chapter 31, and this speaks of the pursuit of Laban after Yaqub. We found some reasoning by his gods to try to keep him from taking his daughters. He gave him the price of a king for Rachel. He labored for them. It says here in Genesis chapter 31, verse 30, Laban says, and now you have left because you greatly long after your father's house, Yet wherefore have you stolen my gods? You have labored for me. You long for the promises of Abraham. Yet you have robbed me of my gods. You have stolen. Well, I'm here to destroy every damn god. And beginning with the god of your belly. That drives you. That drives us away from Yah. That defines Yah to us. It's a dirty damn god. He's a dirty dog. He's a vile thing. And I oppose him in every facet, in every way. And I raise up the standard of Yah against every damn god. You have stolen my gods. We see from here and before then a tremendous proliferation of the many gods, of the many Baal. And the god was of such damn diminutive stature that you could literally hide it in a sack of grain. Damn that god. I don't fear saying that. Damn the equivalent of a god. This is the Baal that you bow down to. The damn thing can speak, can eat, can even wipe its own buttocks. And you bow down to that. You bow down to the god of your damn twisted belly, that it is a cesspool of stench that always growling and consume everything that is wicked and unclean. We can't even wipe our buttocks without the strength of Yah. You can't even wipe it. You can't even clean yourself without the mercies of Yah. His nochan, the hasid of Yah, his kindness. And we arise with such illness in our heart to offer up a drink offering and a stench offering to your damn god, and you don't offer nothing to Yah. You're wicked. And I come against you with everything that is in me. Everything he grants to me, all the strength, I come against you and your damn god. And I defy your god. Now we can open this booklet, all right? Page 1. You that have joined us, again we greet you. You can go to the web. You're on the website. If not, and you can download this booklet. And you can read along with us. It's quite a few pages, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to read most of this or bring out some valid points. You keep this, you go over it, you search, reference this against Torah, and prove me wrong. That's all I ask you to do. I don't mind you proving me wrong. Just make sure you prove me wrong. Prove me wrong, all right? I began this little booklet. These are my words here in the first 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 little paragraphs. It says, you that have joined us, this booklet is an extension of the teaching series titled Damn All the Gods. God damn them all. The information in this booklet is based upon the research that I have done to give us all a clearer picture of the God identity. This information in this booklet is not based upon my opinion, but it is based in the information that I have retrieved from some of the most credible resources in this nation. This information has come from resources like 1, the College Merriam-Webster Number 6 Dictionary, Online Etymology Dictionary, Wikipedia, Oxford English Dictionary, the Encyclopedia, different sources, the Britannica and different sources, and also other credible sources that deal with the linguistics origin, the beginning of words, concept, speech. So I have retrieved all this information from that. It is not something that something spoke to my mind like the liars speak today. It was retrieved by the credible resources that we accredited as having the knowledge to speak on certain matters more precisely than we can. Does that make sense? All right, then. I will proceed. I have not taken the time to accredit each resource that I have used, but you can rest assuredly that the meaning of the word words are not a credit to me in any form. I am not the originator. The booklet and the teachings are to expose this damnable demonic thing many call God. We began here in the origin of this twisted title that many want to call Yahweh, the Most High. And I began here in this booklet, as you can see, from the ethnology. And the word ethnology, it is simply the origin of a word. It is the creative mind of the one to create a word. Listen, every word is created out of objects, things that are presently known to a society that they create words to describe something of a nature that is of the same resemblance of those things. That's what etymology is. Etymology, it is the origin. It is the concept of the word, what it is based upon, the purpose and why it is created. And every word is created to create a picture, an image, a thought, a concept in one's mind. That's why HaShatan said, the day you defy Yah, you will be a god, knowing what is Rach and Taf. And that is what etymology is. So I began here, the things that I have underlined it, and the things that I must read in order for you to understand. If I don't read it, you will not understand. And most of us will lay it down and never pick it up again. It says this. This is from the online etymology dictionary. The word God. I want to define it. And we must understand, listen, Shemach Yisrael. It is one thing about language. Language. The speech, the utterance, the Lashon. That's what language is. And when you see the word Lashon, and that is what must be taught on as well, the Lashon. Well, you see the L-A-W, Shon, hyphen, S-H-O-N-E, Lashon. It is talking about the tongue, but it is talking about language and speech and utterance. That's what the Lashon. And the word law, it is to lay down an order or a pattern, a definitive of what is to be said, stated, and what it means. That's what a definitive is. It cannot be doubted. It is settled. It is imperial. That's what a definitive is. And so the Lashon is what speaks language. And you can only create a language by those things that appear unto you, you perceive. That's what HaShatan said, the day that you defy him, your mind, Pachat, it shall be open, you'll become open-minded. If you want to sleep with the dogs, that's all right. If you want to sleep with a man, that's right. You justify that even out of the book. Do they do that? All right then. Men with men, women with women. Women with dogs, men with donkeys. Hallelujah. And we with every kind of unclean spirit. Damned every God. Damned them all. Moving quickly. Or it began here out of the words, here with the word gods. The online etymology dictionary. Began here with what they call Old English. Now, I know in this nation, well, if the people of the diaspora learn how to speak proper English, well, you tell me who speak what they call proper English. This damn twisted generation. Oh, English, God, it implies supreme being or deity. And the words that are parentheses in red, I say here that we will define this word as well. I will discuss that later on. The word deity and divine. There are things that no one has to tell me when I hear certain words. I know that there is a twist to the definitive of those words. And I eradicate them immediately. As a young man, I began to expand certain things out of my vocabulary. I just don't say them. I've never used them. It says, the Christian God, image of a God, God-like person. Now, a person that determines what's right and wrong by their own predilection, what they perceive to be right. It is from the word gutan. Gutan, old French, du, God, old High German, Gott. Gott. And the old Nordic, from Gothic, Gup, and from Pi, which is the Proto-Indonesia European, it is from Gut, that this is the derivative of the word God. So each nation has formed a definitive of what we call God. And from the processing of these words, we conclude or we establish what a God is. Now, we got to understand what the definitives of these words are, all right? And the, from Pi or Gut, which, that which is invoked. Now, that's what they use to define what they call God, that which is invoked. So they took that from the Proto-European Indonesian vernacular, that is to invoke. And then from that SKT, when you see that in definition, it is called the Sankris, Sankris. I know we don't, as a people, we don't have time for stuff like this, but it is vital that we learn. It is one thing about the Sankris language. I will show you that as we proceed. Sankris, which means Hutta, invoke. An epithet of Indra, just like India. Do you all see that? Now pay attention to me, all right? Don't worry about nothing else. Of Indra. Now, from root, the uts, to call, that which to invoke. But some trace it back to the Pi or Proto-Indonesia European gutto, to pour. This is what God is now, to pour, from root, ya'ud, to pour a libation, and the word libation, it is Latin, the act of pouring a liquid as wine, either on the ground or on the victim in a sacrifice to a deity. This is the origin of this word. This is how it has morphed into what we call God, of all of these different definitives, different meanings of what to try and to strive or to destroy the Most High. This, it is an amalgamation of damn trash, filthiness. Can I move a little further? It tells us the source of Greek, chin, to pour, also the phrase, hut, ga'a, to pour earth, listen. You see what I have underlined there, referring to a burial mound. Now that is what some of the combinations of the word God means. When they look at the burial mound, they engraft or they grafted all of those words into this. This is etymology. You can't argue against it. The burial mound. It says, given the Greek facts and the grammatic or the dramatic form, many have referred it in the first instance of the spirit that emanate, or the spirit that emanates in the burial mounds. Watkins, he speaks of that in his writings. Also, Zeus, that's why he is known as Christ or Jesus, Zeus. And if you look at the original 1611, I have one. You will never find the name Jesus, but you will find this word spelled this way. And I will bring that to our attention one day. Zeus. It is spelled that way in many applications in the original 1611 with the Apocrypha. And all of that is, I have a copy of the first 1611 KJV. I have one. I have a facsimile of that. The same form of writing and all of that. You will never find the word. You will find the word Jesus. But not Jesus, Jesus, in the 1611. Because it is not a word, it is a hybrid form. It is a god of darkness. Now, I read here in this booklet of the word Indra or India, Indra, It says here in the word, here the word Indra, it means, the word Indra, Deva Agera, also called Nakhara, writing system. Now that Indra is a system of writing. It is a system of linguistics. It is a system to express words in writing. That's all Indra is. That's all it is. It is vital that we understand this. We can see the concept of this word God, some of the most damnable and despicable things where it has derived from. He says of Sakhra, Sakhra is the king of the demagogues or the demigods. We've heard that word. These are the demagogues or the demagogues or divas of the Lord of Heavens, Asivra Galuha. In Hindu mythology, he is also the god of war, a storm, and the rainfall. So the words of the Indra that associate with God, these are the words of descriptive analogy of the gods of the Hindu language. That's what Sanskrit of the Sanskrit language is. It is the language of Hinduism. It is the language of Hinduism. It is the language that worship in the Hindu gods, which total around 3 million plus. Many gods, many lords. Well, in Hinduism, there are many gods. Just like in Christianity, there are tens of millions of gods in Christianity. And so that's what the word Sanskrit. It's one of the first things I learned many, many years ago, Sanskrit, the language of the Sanskrit. I recall Evangel Hirschfeld saying to me, son, you must understand words and they're archaic and the form in which they were pronounced. He said, look in the dictionary, you see the word archaic, A-R-C-H-I-C, archaic. He said, it defines the originality of the word. I didn't know anything about etymology, I did not know. But I did not take that and lay down with it. I took it and ran. I took the instructions of a wise man. We are a foolish generation. We don't like the instructions of a wise man. And it has taught me much. Just that little word that he said to me, it taught me much. Those little few words, the archaic, son. Hallelujah. So we search the word Indra, what it means, Indra, what it means, how it derives, and what it's for. It goes on to say, Indra is one of the chief deities in the Rigveda, of the Rigveda, and that is the four canticles, sacred texts of Hinduism. That this is the language. This is the chief deity in their writings. Whereby we find the word, its motive, it is an intent, it has come from, it is derived from the very attributes of their god, Rigveda. He is celebrated in the demiurge, the subordination god who fashioned the sensible world in the light of eternal ideas. He is the one that fashioned the world. He is the one, that's what it implies, he's the one that fashioned the world and pushed up the sky. Release Don Ashas and the Vala cave. Both latter action are central to Soma, the ritual drink of importance. Now, Soma is the drink that was poured out in regard to the god or this god of the Hinduism sacrifice. Carefully now. On the other hand, he also commit, like Zeus, many kinds of mischief for which he is sometimes punished. He has many epithets, notably the bull, slayer of Mahavan, the bountiful. Indra appears as the name of an archdemon in Zoroastrian, a religion. I will define that as well, but that is what it appears as. So the meaning of what they call God, it has its origin in the description of demons and powers of hell. You can look at it any way you want to. We can be foolish and gullible. Your mother taught you and me what God meant, and that's what we believed it meant, because she was taught and she was ignorant. And the disguises of words, they were sharp in their subtleness. Was not Hashatan the most subtle creature in the garden? Was he not slick and wicked, full of mischief? So we define words by what we have been taught. You don't look, and we don't look up one damn word. We don't search out the origin of nothing. We don't see what it means. We don't see what it defines, what doors it is trying to open. And when we call him God, we'll open up the doors to the demonic powers of hell. I don't care if it's your son, your daddy, your children. That is the truth. I had a man that called me last night after the broadcast. He said, Riach, you're such a great blessing to me and your words. I hear from people like that. Are you just calling me? I listen to you all the time, my house. And the man tells me of the story. This woman that he married, she was receptive to the name and truth. Well, of course, after some time after they were married, she began to refute what he was saying. He says to me, he said, I married this woman. And she had 7 children. And none of them were mine. And I loved her. That's to find that today. 7 children. What man wants to take on that harsh responsibility? He began to talk about how she began to rebel against truth. And her elderly son. And he said, the woman put me away. She divorced me. 7 children. And you're trying to divorce someone? And she began to vehemently fight against the name of Yah, his truth, and began to call upon the gods. When you call on the gods, you're opening up the doors, the caves to some of the most darkest, devious powers. That's why we have done so evil, and we don't even understand our evilness. We have been so blinded, we don't even know we are blinded and wicked. We have wrought such evil, we don't even know we are working evil. We have done things so wickedly and violently against Yisrael and Yah that we have no conscience of guilt of what we do. That's a sick mind. We can see in the etymology of this word, as I define the origins and the meaning, it has nothing to do with the beauty of Yah's creation. Nothing. With demons and gods of the imagination and the created being, that's what it's all about. It goes on to say in the Puritan or the Puritanic mythology, Inra is bestowed with heroic and almost brash and amour or this amorous character at times. Even as his reputation role diminished in the latter Hinduism with the rise of Timurith, it says, Indra is called Sakra frequently in Vedas, and in Buddhism, he is known in the Brahmis. I stayed here. I want to examine the word deity, as I said I would. I use the word definitive. And the word definitive, it implies the most authoritative, reliable, complete, usually with the implication of final and perfect completeness of precision used to search scholarship or criticism. So when something has a definitive, it is settled. It has been searched or researched by the scholars. They have come to the conclusion that it is the finiteness of this action. So the word deity, we must include all this to understand the word God and the twisted damnation of that to apply it to Yah. It says, I want to examine the word deity, which I said I would. The definitive and origin of the word has nothing to do with me, how I would or would define it. But the original purpose of the word, how it was defined, deity. And I define this from the resources that you can find. It's from the College Merriam-Webster 6th Dictionary, the etymology, Middle Eastern, Middle English, deity, from Middle French, deity, from late Latin, datat or datas. I'm not going to read all that. Probably translated of the Greek, theosis. Theosis. You hear the Greek or you hear folks saying, well, he is Theos, Theos. You hear that among the damnable Greek thumpers and the twisted Christians. Theos. From the Latin, it is du es, God, and all of the affinities. But I want you to drop down to where it says twig or T-R-W. God of war. Old German, it is Zeus. Old Norris, it is Tare. God of war. From the Gothics, it is Sentius, daily. Latin, it is divus, divine, God, dies, day, dies day. Do you hear that? This is what divine is now. And Jupiter, this is what it defines. When you say the divinity of Yah, you're saying that the power of Jupiter, or Jupiter, and I will show you something in the book of Jupiter. God of the sky, Greek it is Deus, heavenly, Zeus. This is not my damn writing. This is from scholars, from researchers. I didn't write a damn thing. We are so ignorant we can't see it, and we say, well, I know I said that, but I just believe it. Granny say, well, baby, I was brought up this way, so I gotta believe it. You're full, Granny. This is what it says. Greek, Deus, heavenly, heavenly, which means Zeus, God, sky. And this is the catalyst here, because we're going to see this Sankrisk, diva. Women call themselves, I'm a diva, baby. Diva, God, Deus, sky, day, basic meaning, sky. I know what the word day, we use the word day, but actually Yah says it's yom. It is Yah's time. It is a measure of time. Yom. Yam. There are many things we should not say. I won't have chance today, but I may preach the latter part of this, of the pure language of Yisra'iyah, out of the book of Tzephaniah. We need to hear that. I want to finish this today. It says here, as I wrote down the scripture, as Shaul and Barnabas, as one was healed there in Lystra. It says here in the book of Maaseth Shilishim, the Acts of the Apostles, Acts 14:9. It says, and the same heard Shaul speak, who firmly looked him and perceived that he had emunah to heal. He had power to heal, and they knew the gods could heal. They knew that. Said with a loud voice, stand up. Shaul says, stand up straight on your feet. And the man leaped and he walked. And when the people saw what Shaul had done, they lifted their voices in the speech of the Lucanians, in their language, in their speech. They lifted their voices and they said this, not the God, but the gods are come down to us in the likeness of men. And look at what they bestowed upon them. And they call Barnabas Manova, that's his name. They call him Jupiter, which is Zeus. And they call Shaul Mercurius, which is Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. They knew the power of the gods. And the gods had made themselves known unto the people of Lystra, just like your God has made himself known unto you. And they gave them the specifics of that. Before I read this, in the Greek, Deus, heavenly Zeus, it says in the Gothics, Latin, it was Jupiter. And they called them the gods that push the heavens up, the gods of healing, when they wrought the power of Almighty Yah in the midst. So words, that's why we're going to be judged by every idle word. We have to be careful. We have to curtail our speech. That's why we should be quick to hear and slow to speak. Because you don't know what you're calling on, Yisra'iyah. This is a language of Babel, a language that confused the minds of the people. When we say yes, we mean no. We say no, we mean yes. We say stop, we say keep going. Sure we do. When you say I love you, you mean I hate the hell out of you. How many times I've heard people say, I will stand with you until the day. In hell, where are they? Where are they? Where's your heart?
We're full of our own ways. It is the truth. We don't want to confront the issues in us. You're always confronting someone else, issue, but you don't want to confront what's in you. We must be reminded daily that our pure minds may be stirred up by way of remembrance. And that's why we don't want to hear anything about Yah. We want to hear things about that folly. They said that these men worked the power of Yah. Now, what I have done here for our own references and your own concordance, nothing that I wrote. It says here in the Greek lexicon, damn the Greek, I don't like it. But if you go to your concordance in the Greek lexicon and Strong, the number is 2203. It is Deus. It is Zeus. That's what it says. Just like I have it here. Jupiter meaning the father of help. That's what it means. He's the father of succor, of help, was the Greek Zeus. The Olympian Zeus was the national god of the Hellenistic race, as well as the supreme ruler of the heathen world. So when you call on your god, you're calling on a damn heathen because you are a damn heathen. We are damn twisted heathens, so they call on a damn heathen god. As such form of the true opposite of Almighty Yah. Well, in the Greek concordance, it doesn't use the word Yah, but it used the word in the complete opposite of, quote, God, unquote. And that's what it is. And this is what the etymology of the word God, how it has derived, has it been formed in our minds and been shaping in our conscience. And we call Yah a damn demon. We call him a damn dirty dog. We call him a damn beast. We call him Zeus. We call him Jupiter. If you call him nothing else, you call him the Most High. I don't like the word El Elyon because it has been polluted. I like Yah Yahan. Hallelujah. That's why I don't like, if you say the word Yisra'el or Yisra'el, you don't say it El El. It is El, A-L-E. It's not E-L. It is Yisra'el. That's why I enunciate it Yisra'el. I do that. That's my personal preference. Yisra'el, those that prevail by the power of Almighty Yah. It is difficult for us to transform our minds by the renewing of the Ruach of Yah. We are so lazy, that's why we don't ever do it. So instead of calling him the Aramaic, we say lazy. Or Deacon Horn. No, he's not Deacon Horn. Damn Deacon Horn, that name. He's not a Deacon Horn to me. He's Zachin. Instead of calling him Yavasadach, hey bro Chris, no. We're brand new me and Yahshua. This is a brand new life. Brand new individual. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Change. Just like he did Yaakov, your dirty little thing at Yaakov, you are a supplanter. And I give you a name that shows you shall prevail. So I want a name that prevails in him. In him. In Yah. I'm not ashamed of it. You may be, but I'm not. Been named after the damn dirty gods on the damn dirty god system to show the attachment to the damn bearers of brutality on the people of Yah and those that are of the diasporas here. Damn that. Damn it all. Damn it all. Well, I'm too old. No, I'm not too old. Turn from your wicked ways. And you damn false Hebrews that use the damn word God and Lord and Jesus, and you change your damn corrupt name to a name that is Hebraic, you are a cowardly, weak thing. They know where to find me. Just like that Beth from Philadelphia caller, you can almost type in any word, and I appreciate my Ach Simeon, and I will split his head, I will split his back, and then I will prepare his plate for him to eat. I will be his servant. He does an excellent job. Yeah, I will prepare his plate. I know how he likes it. I know how to fix it. And I make sure. Sit down, man. I'll serve you. I wash your feet and kiss them.
You're an ignorant people. You're an ignorant people. He's not in here. Let make sure he gets something. Isn't that amazing? He that is gadol among you, let him be the servant of Yah's house. You serve. You want to be great, serve. Get off your lazy tush and do something for someone. See, the gods won't allow you to do that. I don't need no one to tell me what to do because I want to do the things that please Yah. I work jobs, they never had to tell me what to do. I did it. If you were doing a process, I want to learn how you do it. If I had 20 minutes free time, no, I didn't sit in the break room to drink coffee. I didn't even congregate with the wicked like that. No, sir. Very few people that I would even associate with. And I'm still like that today. Because when I show you my love, it's genuine. It's not false or pretense. I was thinking this morning, there was a man that stood in this pulpit, in this rostrum here, read, I don't like the word pulpit, and he read things, read a letter, and the same cowardly man turned against me. And I was thinking, I said, you know, he talked about what he did for Yisrael. And I remember one day, we collectively, I don't do anything on my own because I have no resources to do that. We purchased this man some beautiful clothing and shoes and watch, had them specially shipped to him, and he was just overtaken by that. And yet the same cowardly beast turned against me for someone that walks around all the time with his mouth open. It is the truth. These cowards. I'd rather have warriors on my side. I don't want no weak Jezebel men. Go on. Get away from me. I want warriors. I want those that are ready to go to the trenches. I like to fight. I like to fight. I do. Now let them fall off, Oxymeon. It says Mercurius, meaning herald of the gods. Probably Hermes, the Greek deity, whom the Romans identifies with their Mercury, and the god of commerce. Ah, and bargain. You see the god of this nation? The god of commerce. You see, that's the god they preach in their whole houses. God wants you to have much. God wants you to have riches. God wants you to be businessman. God wants you this. They're calling on their gods, Mercury. This is the truth, Yisrael. Was not Hashatan, we must go back to the Bereshit. Was he not the most subtle creature in the garden? Was he not the most subtle, and that is the most seductive, most seducive one, the one that had the ability to allure with the power of his Loshon? The 14th chapter, verse 13, as we read here. Then the priest of Zeus, it says that in the KJV, it tells you he is the priest of Zeus, which was before the city, they brought oxen and garlands to the gates and would have done sacrifice with the people. Which when the Shulishim by Nova Barnabas and Shaul heard of it, they tore their clothes and they ran in among the people and they cried. They cried out and said, sir, why do you these things? We are also as men of like passion as you, and preach to you that you should turn from these damnable vanities, these shall their empty things, to the living Abba, to the mighty one. Damn God, damn Mercury, Jupiter. Yah gave Orion his name. He gave the celestial powers their names. Man has taken them and identified them as gods. He said, you should turn from these empty things. Turn from your Jesus. Turn from your Lord. Turn from your God. And turn to the living Abba, which made Hashemayim, the earth, the sea, and all things therein. He made it all. Turn from our damn empty gods. Turn from the God of your belly. They keep you empty and dry and keep you in your putrefied, weak state of mind. You have no damn strength to do anything. I can do all things. I can do everything. I can do the mighty things through the power of Yahshua that strengthens me. We can't even control our damn greedy flesh. Talk to me, Yisrael. Ain't nothing we can't do because we serve the gods, the God of our belly. We're like beasts of the field. I will, man. If he takes every fiber of my strength, I lay it all on the line when I'm here. Lay out everything. Now I don't have the dorsal voice. I'm not going to speak with quietness. I'm going to cry out. You teachers teach the way you teach. I'm going to cry out. I'm not sparing nobody. Your mama, your daddy, not even you, my friend. Hallelujah. I'll continue reading. In the ancient Greek religion, Zeus, ancient Greek, modern Greek, Zeus, the father of gods and men, the ruler of the Olympians of Mount Olympias, a father rule the family. He is the god of sky and thunder in the Greek mythology. His Roman counterpart is Jupiter. Etruscan counterpart is Tina, god of the sky and the highest god of the Etruscan mythology, equivalent to the Roman Jupiter and the Greek Zeus. And I define that, you see the red writing, it is not my definition. I read to us and show you what the Etruscan scan were. It was a diachronically continuous population with a distinct language of culture. It was a people of their own culture and their own language. In the early European writings in the Mediterranean Iron Age in the second half of the first millennium BC. Now that describes the people, all right, the Etruscans. Now it's the reason that I define these words, to show you how the morphing of this word, how it has produced this damn false image in our minds that everyone has a god today. Hallelujah. The appearance of the spirit of the angels who led the people in error. I want to show you this now here in the book of Hanukkah. It says in Hanukkah 19:1, and Uriel said to me, here stand in many different appearance of the spirits of the angels. That's what I call them, angels. They are not the Melechim, they are not a Melach, which have united themselves with women. They have defiled the people and will lead them into error so that they will offer sacrifices to demons as unto gods. That's what we're doing. You never heard people say, I got a demon in me. They do things. They can't rid that of themselves. There are all kinds of demons. And people have all kinds of demons, whether it's lust demons of their sexual proudness, of their eating demons, of their unclean demons. The house is filthy as hell. Women that their bodies unclean. Men that are punkish and effeminate. There are all kinds of demons. They're slave demons. They're lazy demons. They're slothful demons. They're not men of their minds and their conscience is not led correctly. Hallelujah. He speaks of those that defile themselves and they have brought forth sons and daughters who offer sacrifices to demons as unto gods until the great day of Yah's judgment in which they shall be judged till they all be finished. They're all coming to an end, all the gods. And you can see what I also included there in 1 Corinthians, though there be many gods and many lords. And that's what we are worshiping, gods and lords, and they are the most damnable, despicable, fallen creatures out of the darkness of the annals of time. They have defied Yah. They have created images, concepts, thoughts, and languages to hide their mystical power as gods. You damn fools that call his name Hayah, it is simply a verb. A name is a pronoun. A name is a pronoun. It is a specific person, place, or thing. They won't challenge me. These boys have about as much strength as white loaf bread. Ain't nothing to that. Give me some of that wheat bread. Thick and heavy. Some of that Ezekiel bread. Some that stick to your bone. That's what they have. Cannot go around. Again, hear the word God in its original creation. This is what it implies. It is not related to good, or the word we call good. Originally, it was neuter. You understand what the word neuter means? Belonging to, connected with, or grammatically formed, referred characteristically to the thing that is neither masculine nor feminine. The original creation of the word God, it was never masculine nor feminine. It was just a damn twisted word. The Torah tells me that Yah is a man of war. That's what he is. He's not a woman of war. He's a man. A milchaya. He likes to fight. So in its original form, this is not what I have deducted of my own properties of intellectualism, because I don't have that. It is what I have scoured and looked to define this word by the most credible, reputable books on the land. It was neither, had no gender. When you said God, you didn't know when you're talking about a female or male. It was a freak. That's what it is. That's what a God is, a freak. That's why the angels, those that fell, they lost their state as a melach, a melechim. They became angels, demons of darkness. Los Angeles, isn't that one of the most wicked cities? That's the only city in the world named Los Angel. No other city. You got Hollywood, Florida. You got Hollywood. No other city that is called Los Angeles. No other city in the world. That's the only city that's called that. And it is crazy as hell. And it is twisted. It has no originality. It said, not related, originally neuter, now in the dramatic or the German language. It says here, you see the underline, the gender shift to masculine after the coming of Christians. That's who changed it to a masculine deity or a form of a masculine thing. These damn Christian Christos, which mean fools and foolish ones. The O-E means, O English, God was probably closer in the sense of the Latin numen. A better word translate Deus might have been Proto-German. Anzus, like Jesus. This is not my writing. But this was used only of the highest deities of the Germanic, of the German religion. See, the only ones that were called gods were those in the German religion, or the deities of the highest state, and not of foreign gods. Man, you got gods that are foreign and gods that are of the people, not of the foreign gods. And it was never used of the Christian God. So the word God was never used for what they call God. The Lord God Jesus is a damn demon. How about that? Tell your mama that and your daddy that. It's a damn demon. It survives in English mainly in the personal names beginning in us. I could not find anything on the word us. Believe me, I look days and hours and time, wake up, but I could not find anything. Hallelujah. It says the interchangeable use of the word God, God bless after someone sneezes, is credit to now. You don't hear me saying that. I know what the Torah says, that when a man sneezes, that the ruach goes out of the man, the breath goes out of the man. Sure it does. Shit! Your breath goes out. That doesn't mean life goes out. Oh, God bless. Hell, I don't say that. It began here with St. George the Great. But yet people would say, oh, God bless. They don't even know what this is. We're stupid. We are sadist people. It began that with St. George the Great. But the pagan Romans, this is not how I define it, but the pagan Romans and Greek had similar customs. And these are some of the customs and some of the words that were introduced. I'm not going to go through all of them. See, you find folks say, you are God-awful. That means you are terrible, the second word. But yet, that's not blasphemy. That damn God isn't. The damn God is awful. Oh, you are God-awful. And then they call them, this is my God-child. Child that has been baptized under the auspice of the gods. This is my God-daughter. You've heard that? Go down here to the late 14th century from the word God-damn. He's cussing out. That's not what it meant. It was from the form God plus damn. That's all it is. That's all the word means. It is through the morphing of definite. You can't say anything about God. Well, damn God, damn God. How about that? Damn God. You can get quiet and get all upset, but that's all right. And the word God damn is, see, this is where the word God damn is. It was a nickname given by the Puritans to the Calvins, that's really what Cavaliers, in consequence of the latter support frequently employed to that oath. When they would say that oath, God damn is, they would say, let them be damned. These folks don't know God. And yet they knew their God, but yet the God of the Cavalierians were different than their God. The white God is different from the black God from the Chinese God from the Greek God from the Viennese God. Come on, Yisrael, don't, let us not be ignorant. Hell, these whole houses will be segregated tomorrow. Just like this one. All the Caucasians go here, all the folks of the diasporas go here, all the Viennese go here, and all the Greeks go here. Talk to me. We can say what we want to. Because gods of the other ethnicities or the other people of the earth, they don't even respect those gods. The white God doesn't give a damn about the black God. The black God doesn't give a damn. It's trying to please the white God to get some kind of root connection with him. And yet, damn, his damn God came from that twisted damn white mind. You all don't get upset with me when I say that. It's a damn polluted, convoluted damn mindset. They create these damn lies and the damn images. You see nothing here that in the meaning of these words come from anything that's Afrocentric, from the nation of Kamats, from the dark continent. You see nothing here at all. I don't give a damn what you say. You see nothing. So I know what I'm saying. Hallelujah. Let's go on down. We got Godfather. Hell, one of the most powerful movies in America was The Godfather, wasn't it? Talk to me, Yisrael. He's the baddest boy in town. Godfather. He talked that talk and he killed everybody, but he was the Godfather. That's what gods do, they kill. Hallelujah. They talk about the Godhead in the 12th century. See, all these words you can see, the godless. It's godless, down close to the bottom. It is a form God plus less, related to godlessness. Phrase godliness, communist attest in 1851. So many of these words are just new words created from the spirit of the gods. Godmother, mother who sponsored a baptism. Oh, Godspeed on you. Yet they don't think that's blasphemy. Damn the gods, be damn the gods, damn them all, Yisrael, damn every god. Hallelujah. It was a parting salutation. Look at this word. Look on the next page. You see that as a parting salutation in the mid-15th century, demigod or demigod. You ever heard the word demigod? You hear that all the time in the political arena, the demigod, demigod. But this is what a demigod is. This is not my definitive of it. A demigod, the word, the 15th century, from demi plus god, the child of sexual intercourse between the deity and a mortal, a man raised to divine rank, or a minor god. That's why they call them demigod. Or you're a demigod. See, these men are, these are unclean men. These politicians, hell, Obama and all of them, they're unclean. Bane and all these wicked children of hell, they're wicked, vile men. If you tell me you've never heard that word demagogue, these are the demagogues. They think they have power over everyone. That's the way these twisted little damn phonies think. They know they're gods. That's my words. We don't understand the power of them. I was saying the other day to one, we were looking at some words. I was saying, we must define words and understand. You speak from the approach of divinity, of absolute what it means. I don't come to you in here half-cocked. I put us in the crosshairs of Yah. You have to understand. Time out for the lazy trolling of nothing. Our lives must be productive. I'm looking for something in the kingdom to come. That's why I want to work now. Get it all in. The old song, payday is coming after a while. I want the payday. I want to be paid. I want to receive the mark of the price of the calling of Omar Yan Yahshua. I want to hear the words, well done, my beloved son. You know what I was thinking of? They said, boy, you know, I don't care how we cry and how we spout, we're going to die. And I know my years are not far off. I know that.
Let the works I do speak for me. I want my works to do. I want the works of Sadiq, because every man is going to be judged by his works. You can kid yourself, my heart. You can pretend all you want to. You can put up a damn nice front with your heart, your ach, and you got some devious damn wickedness in your heart. You're going to hell. You're going to hell. Your works, you're going to be judged by your works. I don't give a damn how you think, and the works of your heart. And they're going to be manifest. You better get it right. And there's no time to hear things over and over and over again. When we hear the emet of Yah, we should not harden our heart. Damn the gods. You don't harden your heart against Yah for a damn wicked demagogue or damn god that this mutation. That's what Shaitan did. He had an intercourse in the mind of Shafa and produced these demagogues, these damn demons and gods. That's why I say you're gods, you're demagogues, you have the status of a god. Don't run out and tell your damn thing. That one that sits there on the mountain of the north, tell him you're not going to instruct me. It is yes. It is yes. And time for us to get it right. And play it around too much. Too much. Hallelujah. The etymology of the word God in the early writings of the Germanic or the language of the Germans, that's all it is, the grammatics. Word comes from the 6th century, the Christian Codex Argentius, the Civil Bible, the Euphelas. That's an interesting thing, the study of the Euphelas, the translation of the Christian Bible into Gothic. The English word itself is derived from the Proto-German Germanic, and the Proto-German Germanic language is not directly attested by any surviving text, but has been reconstructed using the comparative method. Gudan. Most linguistics agree, see the linguistics agree, that the reconstruction of the Proto-Indo-European form of Gutum, which based on the root Gut, which mean either to call or to invoke, the German word for God was originally neutered, belonging to the connection with or grammatically forms referring characteristically to the things that are neither masculine or German. It had no identity as this masculine thing they call God. It applied to both gender, but during the process of Christianization of the German people from the indigenous German paganism, they were damn pagans. They didn't know Yah. The word became a masculine syntax, a word from or a form of a system of a noun classes to a gender type system. Every noun must belong to one of the classes, and there should be very few that belongs to several unclasses that are untouched. Now listen, the capitalization form God was first used in the Euphelas, or the Wufela, the Gothic translation of the New Testament, to represent the Greek theos. In the English language, the capitalization continues to represent a distinction between the monotheses or the doctrine that believe that there's only one God. You've heard of the monotheses, God and gods, the polytheses, which believe there are multiple gods. In spite of significant difference between religions such as Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, you all hear that. You read this, Hinduism, the Baha'i faith, and Judaism, the term God remains an English translation. That's what it is. Common to all. It has no damn meaning. It's a demon. And they're all ran by demonic powers. I don't give a damn if it's Judaism, Islam. These are demons that run this twisted, wicked religion. Yah called his people to a way of higher life, high to live. The name may signify any related or similar monotheistic deities, such as the monotheist as the Akhenaten, pharaoh of the 18th century of the dynasty of Egypt, or the Zoroastrianism, a religion philosophy based upon the teaching of Zoroastrians. Hallelujah. When used within the English community with the common monotheistic background, God always referred to the deity now they share. Those with a background in different Abrahamic religion
We usually agree on the deity they share. While still deferring to the details of belief and doctrine, they will disagree on the attributes of the God rather than think the term of my God and your God is different. If it's a God, it's a damn dog. If it's a God of Judaism, it's a damn dog. If it's a God of Christianity, it's a damn dog. If it's a God of Hinduism, it's a damn dog. If it's the God of Baha'i faith, it is a damn dog. Oh, God is great. What is his damn name? Allah Akbar. Damn Allah Akbar. I'm not afraid to say that. Hallelujah. I'm not going to read all this. I want to read one other thing. You can look at this. The word thesis on the next page, the etymology of the word. I want to read this, the Sanskrit language. And I'm going to close here. I'm tired. It says here in the Sanskrit language, hear this. And you will find if you look words up in the Marian, in any dictionary, you will see that SKT in many applications. It is a Sanskrit. The Sanskrit language is a historical Indo-Aryan language. Listen. And the primary liturgical language, and a language that is cultivated for religious reason by people who speak another language in the daily life. So languages are created so that people may understand. But this language is primarily the liturgical language of Hinduism, Jainism, and Buddhism. This is the language. This is the language that describe their gods, their worship. Buddhism, Buddha, Hinduism have over 300 million gods. And the language of that, and what nations and people do when they're trying to get across something, they take words that are associated with those deities or the worship of a people, and they incorporate that in the language and say, well, this is God. Just like in the Philippines, there's no word for the word God in the Tehula language. And so what they do, they engraft the deities of that language and say, well, this is what we mean. Well, your God is named what? Matoka. Well, Matoka is God. And that's how they do it. This is what this book is talking about, Matoka. To use that as an example, Yisra'iyah. And that's what the enemy has done. He has created the gods. So the black god, the white god, the Jew god, the Arab god, and all these damn gods, they're not worth a damn. Not one of them. There's only one that is mighty, one that is excellent, created all things. He is the Yah of all creation, and by the power, only one name. I don't give a damn what Billy Graham's saying. All of them, damn them all. Only that name, Yahshua HaMashiach. Can we know the power of our Abba and be set free from our sins? If not, we're under the bondage of the damn twisted gods. May the strength of God rest upon you. May he help us all, Yisra'el. I'm going to stop there. I'm all out. Be on my feet for hours. Hallelujah. May he strengthen you, all you that have joined us. May the riches of God rest upon you, Yisra'el. I hope that you're strengthened. I hope that he barach you today. Hallelujah. May Yah barach you, all Yisra'el, you that have joined us. May the riches of God rest upon you all, the Mishpah of Yisra'iyah. Be strengthened, for Yahshua is coming soon. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I go around? I said to Yosipi, I want him to. We're going to start singing that song. And let there be love shed among us. Let there be love in our lives. Me now your Torah, sweep my life. And cause your Torah to arise. Give us a fresh understanding of the beauty of Yahshua that is so true. See, we need that. In all things, my Abba, we barak you in Yahshua's name to strengthen your people. Guide us this day. Let these simple teachings of truth permeate in our love, impregnate our minds, that we be not fearful of the gods, but we stand with the sword of the Ruach, the Torah, Yahshua, the witness of that mighty power of your heart. And give that strength unto Yisra'iyah as we bow before you here in Yerushalayim to offer up the abundance of our Todah unto you for all that you have done. Strengthen us all, give us all rest on this Shabbat. And we bless you for the coolness of this beautiful day in Yeshua's name. Hallelujah. Bless your people around the world. Strengthen them and all Yisrael over them and each of us here and our family. What everyone we ask and the blessed assurance of the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, we bless you. And with the volume of our love, we cry hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yabrak Yisrael. Todah.